Hello, my name is Jane Banks, and I'm going to tell you about what happened to me and my brother Michael when we were children. A very unusual nanny by the name of Mary Poppins came to stay with us. Let's begin. It all started when Katie Nana resigned. You see, Michael and I were flying our new kite in the park when the wind got hold of it and snatched it away. We chased after it, but Katie Nana thought we were running away from her. So she marched straight home and told our mother.
Mrs. Banks, I have something to say to you.
Where are the children?
They've disappeared again.
Katie Nana, doesn't it make the third time this week?
The fourth, madam. And I, for one, have had my fill of it.
Gracious, Katie Nana, you're not leaving. What will Mr. Banks say?
Mother didn't have long to wait to find out, for Father came home at his usual time of 6:01 p.m. When she told him that Katie Nana had quit and that we had been missing on account of our kite, Michael held up the tattered evidence.
Perhaps if you helped us to make one.
But Father didn't listen and turned to Mother.
My dear, you've engaged 6 nannies in the last 4 months, and they've all been unqualified disasters. Choosing a nanny for the children is an important and delicate task.
I shall put an advertisement in the Times. Take this down, please.
Mother promptly sat down at her desk, pen in hand.
Yes, of course, dear.
Required. Nanny, firm, respectable, no nonsense.
Later, we came downstairs to say goodnight.
We do so want to get on with a new nanny. That's why we wrote this advertisement.
Father frowned at us.
Wanted a nanny for 2 adorable children.
Our ad went on to say that to apply for this job, one should have a cheery disposition, rosy cheeks, and like to play games. Also, being kind, sweet, and pretty were high on our list, along with going on outings. Father just rolled his eyes.
Now I think we've had quite enough of this nonsense. Please return to the nursery.
The next day, there was a long line of nannies in front of our house. Michael and I watched them from the upstairs window.
I don't understand. They're not what we advertised for at all.
Didn't Father give our ad to the newspaper? Then, suddenly, the wind picked up as it does before a big storm. Some of the nannies had to put up their umbrellas. The next thing we knew, the wind lifted the nannies into the air and blew them higgledy-piggledy down the street. From the opposite direction, we saw someone flying toward us.
Take a look!
Perhaps it's a witch.
Of course not. Witches have brooms.
It's her. It's the person. She's answered our advertisement.
Somehow our message had gotten through. The person came closer and closer.
Rosy cheeks and everything.
Then she flew over the gate and landed on our front porch. Downstairs, we heard her talking to Father. Then she entered the hallway, hopped onto the banister, and magically glided up to the second floor. We threw ourselves against the nursery door in alarm.
Well, don't stand there staring. Best foot forward. Spitzbot!
After following her into the room, we watched her unpack her carpet bag. Oh, the things it held! She pulled out a hat stand and set it on the floor.
I always say the place to hang a hat is on a hat stand.
When she saw our look of amazement, she cautioned us.
Never judge things by their appearance.
Michael poked me.
We better keep an eye on this one.
She's tricky. She's wonderful.
Next, she took out her tape measure.
I want to see how you two measure up.
She started with Michael.
Just as I thought. Extremely stubborn and suspicious. Now you, Jane. Rather inclined to giggle, doesn't put things away.
Michael laughed.
How about you?
Mary measured herself.
Very well. Mary Poppins, practically perfect in every way. Now, shall we get on with it? Our first game is called Well Begun is Half Done, otherwise entitled Let's Tidy Up the Nursery.
And with a snap of her fingers, dresser drawers opened, clothes folded themselves and went inside, and the bed made itself. We were off to the park. On the way to the park, we met Mary's friend Bert. He had just finished making chalk paintings on the sidewalk.
Mary Poppins is taking us to the park.
Not if I know Mary Poppins. What she's probably got in mind is a jolly holiday somewhere or other. Something along these lines, I shouldn't be surprised.
And he walked by his pictures, pointing out the different scenes. I like the one of the English countryside best. It had a road leading to a fair.
Now's the time, Mary Poppins. No one's looking.
We stood in front of the picture, joined hands and jumped. The next thing we knew, we were inside the picture, wearing beautiful clothes.
Come on, I hear the merry-go-round.
Michael and I ran ahead.
Yoo-hoo! Our own private merry-go-round.
When Mary and Bert joined us, the carousel horses took off across the field. All of a sudden, we found ourselves in the middle of a fox hunt. As hounds and huntsmen went charging by, Bert felt sorry for the fox.
Poor little bloke. Let's give him a hand.
He raced ahead and lifted him onto his horse.
Up you go. Now hang on.
Over the hedge they went and onto a racetrack, where a horse race was in progress. And Mary, Michael and I were right behind. Then Mary passed all the racehorses and crossed the finish line first. When the news reporter asked Mary how it felt to win the race, she answered, supercalifragilisticexpialidocious. Then it started to rain, and the magic came to an end, at least for a while. When we got back to the nursery, Mary insisted we take our medicine to keep us from catching colds. When she poured it into the one big spoon, mine came out lime-flavored, but Michael's was strawberry.
Mary Poppins, you won't ever leave us, will you?
Will you stay if we promise to be good?
Oh, that's a pie-crust promise. Easily made, easily broken. I shall stay until the wind changes.
But Mary Poppins, how long will that be?
She didn't say. The next day, everyone in the house was happy. Everyone, that is, except Father. As we were leaving the breakfast table, he was lecturing Mother.
I can tell you one thing, Winifred. I don't propose standing idly by and letting that woman, Mary Poppins, undermine the discipline in my family. There's been something odd, I may say, extremely odd, about the behavior of this household since that woman arrived. And I want you to know that I've noticed it.
When Father came home from work that evening, we tried cheering him up.
Oh, Father, we're so glad you're home.
Hello,
Joe. Oh, children, please return to your room.
He looked to the top of the stairs.
Mary Poppins, will you be kind enough to come with me?
As you wish.
Mary Poppins, I very much regret what I must say to you.
Michael and I slowly marched upstairs, fearing the worst. When Mary came back to the nursery, she told us that Father was taking us on an outing the next day. And not just any outing, but to his bank.
Oh, Michael, the city! And we'll see all the sights and Father can point them out to us.
Well, most things he can. Sometimes a person we love, through no fault of his own, can't see past the end of his nose.
That's when Mary showed us her paperweight of St. Paul's Cathedral. I knew the landmark.
Father passes that every day. He sees that.
But Mary wondered if he saw the old woman who sits on the church steps and feeds the birds day after day. We'd soon find out. The next day, we set out in our best clothes with Father leading the way.
Now remember that a bank is a quiet and decorous place, so we must be on our best behavior.
Michael, look! It's her! The bird woman, just where Mary Poppins said she would be. Please, may we feed the birds?
Michael held out two coins.
I have tuppence from my money box.
Michael, I will not permit you to throw your money away. When we get to the bank, I shall show you what may be done with your tuppence, and I think you'll find it extremely interesting.
The bank was busy that day. Three old men in long black coats came down the hall. One approached Father.
Hello, Banks. What's all this about?
These are my children, Mr. Dawes.
Oh, so I assumed. But why are they here?
They wish to open an account, sir.
And just how much money do you have, young man?
Tuppence, but I want it to feed the birds.
Then an even older man, all bent over and carrying a cane, came up.
Tuppence? Precisely how I started. Well, you know, how is it? Always use more money to put to work for the bank, can't we, boy? So, you have tuppence? May I be permitted to see it?
No, I want it to feed the birds.
Fiddlesticks, boy. Feed the birds, and what have you got? Fat birds. Very well, my boy, give me the money. Welcome to our joyful family of investors.
The man grabbed the money out of Michael's hand.
Give it back! Give me Fred's money!
Michael, behavior!
Suddenly, because of Michael's shouting, all the customers in the bank thought they wouldn't be able to get their money back either. They rushed to the tellers and demanded their cash. Michael grabbed his tuppence and we ran out. We ran down an alley where an old beggar lady tried to grab us. Then a big dog jumped out at us. Frightened, we kept on until we bumped into a ragman covered in soot. It was Bert. He was chimney sweeping that day.
Who's after you?
I clutched his arm.
Father is. He brought us to Sue's bank. I don't know what we did, but it must have been something dreadful.
Well, now there must be some mistake. Your dad's a fine gentleman and he loves you. Fends for himself, he does.
A father can always do with a bit of help. Come on, I'll take you home.
It was Mary Poppins' day off and Mother was on her way out. She looked to Bert for help.
What about you, sir? You've been so kind in looking after the children.
So that's how Bert became our nanny for the afternoon. Michael and I were going to help him clean our chimney. I looked inside.
Oh, it's awfully dark and gloomy up there.
Now, you see how wrong people can be? That there is what you might call a doorway to a place of enchantment.
We heard Mary come in behind us.
Michael, be careful. You never know what may happen around a fireplace.
No sooner had she said that than Michael went whoosh up the chimney. I shouted after him.
Michael, come back down here!
And then I went whoosh up the chimney too. Moments later, Mary and Bert joined us on the roof.
Here you are. I thought you'd left us.
We didn't mean to.
Well, no harm done. This is what you might call a fortuitous circumstance. Look there.
And Bert gazed out at the rooftops.
A trackless jungle. Just waiting to be explored. Why not, Mary Poppins?
Oh, please, Mary Poppins,
please. Oh, well, if we must, we must. Look lovely. Get in line. Attention!
We marched across the rooftops and up a staircase made of smoke to the highest church steeple in London.
What did I tell you? There's the whole world at your feet.
Quite nice, but we should all get in out of the night air. Follow me, please.
Though, as it turned out, we ran into Bert's chimney sweep friends and stayed out on the roof singing and dancing. Then everyone jumped down our chimney to the drawing room and danced with cook, the housekeeper, and even Mother when she got in. When Father came home, he was furious. But all the sweeps politely shook his hand and quickly left. Suddenly the phone rang.
Yes, Banks here. Mr. Dawes, I'm most dreadfully sorry, sir, about what happened to the bank today. I can assure you that... Tonight, sir?
Yes, Mr. Dawes. I shall be there at 9 o'clock.
Father hung up the phone. He looked pale and tired.
Father, we're sorry about the tuppence. We didn't know it would cause you so much trouble.
Here, Father, you can have the tuppence.
Will that make everything all right?
Father slowly nodded his head.
Thank you.
The next day, Michael and I watched Mary pack her carpet bag.
She only promised to stay till the wind changed. Isn't that right, Mary Poppins?
Will you bring me my hat stand, please?
Mary Poppins, don't you love us?
Jane! Michael!
Your father's calling you.
It doesn't sound right, Father.
Run along, Spitzbot.
You won't go, Mary Poppins, will you?
Spitzbot.
Michael and I hurried downstairs to Mother and Father. They were both smiling. father was holding our tattered kite, only it was fixed. Michael jumped up and down.
He mended it.
It's wonderful.
However did you manage it?
Father just laughed and hugged us both. And then our whole family skipped off to the park to try the mended kite. Bert was there, selling new kites. And Mr. Dawes from the bank was there too, flying his own kite. He told Father that he could have his job back. That's when I knew the wind had changed. And when I searched the sky to be sure, there was Mary Poppins flying away. Thank you.